I'm going to have to change the batteries on this in between the worship. So I don't know. The great thing about having a countdown is you guys know when church starts. Right? No surprise. And Rosie, do you want to just tell everyone in the hallway that church has started for me? Do you want to tell everyone in the hallway that church has started? That would be great. Good morning, everyone. I want to read a verse that I don't think many people start church services with. This is a verse from Romans. Because if you know, if you've been to church a lot, you know the way it works. Someone opens with a verse, and it'll be a verse about, maybe from the Psalms, about praising God, or it'll be a verse like Dave opened last week about, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house. And because, you know, we come to meet with Jesus. And so, you know, it's not surprising that we start with a verse or some encouragement about meeting with Jesus. But I want to encourage you about being together as well. So this is what Romans 1, verses 11 to 13 says. This is what Paul was writing to the Romans, and he said this. He said, I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. I don't want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I planned many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now, in order that I might have a harvest among you, just as I've had among the Gentiles. You know, and you know, most of the letters that we, well, all the letters we read are about someone writing to someone else because they're not with them. And when Paul writes this, he's writing because he's not with the church in Rome. And he's telling them, you know, I'm longing to get back together with you so that we can grow together, so that we can mutually encourage each other. And I don't know about you, but I've been longing for these Sundays. You know, and it's not just because we want to meet with Jesus, but we're not like 20, 30 strangers meeting with Jesus. We're people who know each other and have bonds of friendship and love. And so when we come together, we're not just meeting with the King of Kings. We're coming to encourage one another, to build one another. What does he say? That I might impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. And I think that's one of the things we've discovered in praising God in our own homes by ourselves, is that there's a relationship with God, but what we miss is being mutually encouraged. There's nothing like hearing the voices of others. There's nothing like the smiles of others. There's nothing like just being encouraged. And so this morning, as we come to praise God, we're encouraging one another. So I want you to know that you're doing that. You're not only being encouraged by others around there, you are an encouragement. Give me a smile. You're encouraging me. Because a moment ago, you were looking like you didn't know whether you wanted to be here. But now you're smiling, you're encouraging, right? So we're going to praise God this morning. Sharice's going to lead us in worship. I don't know if you've got something you want to say as well, but I'm going to hand over to you.
Yeah, I wanted to read from Revelation 21. It says, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. I read that because of this song we're going to do. It's a celebration. There's a place where the streets shine with the glory of the Lamb. There's a way we can go there. We can live there beyond time. But the reason I chose this song is because of the hope that it has. That I remember the Sunday after my dad passed away, Trevor was leading, and he said to me, is it okay if I do that song? But I found great hope because it says, you know, we'll see you face to face and we will dance together in the city of our God because of you. I just think there's, you know, there's a lot of stuff that we go through, like sickness, like, you know, cancer, depression, and we can live without a lot of things, but if you take away hope, I don't know how people can live without that hope. And that's the hope that Jesus gives us. So let's stand and praise him. There's a place where the streets shine with the glory of the Lamb. We can live there beyond time because of you.
more sadness, no more suffering, no more tears, no more sin, no more sickness, no injustice, no more death.
I will love you, Lord, my Savior.
give me wisdom. You know just what to do.
There is something that just happens in my heart when I hear you all singing together, Hallelujah, Our God Reigns. It's something that we've been able to sing, but together, isn't it just something else? It just gives us a glimpse of what it's going to be like in heaven when there's going to be millions of us all singing God's praise over and over together. Yeah, I just think it's going to be amazing.
Way maker, miracle worker.
Take a seat. And it's a struggle for seats, isn't it? Praise God. It's good to see so many of you here. If you've had to juggle this morning, I really do appreciate it. We're learning as we go. We're learning how many put out and what spaces to have where and who fits where. And so thank you for your forbearance and your patience. It is great to see Guy and Mary and Dan with us this morning. They get the prize of the longest journey of travelling. Well, you only travel from Alpington, right, where you're staying, but you know. And it's so great to have you guys back with us. And it's good to see other faces that weren't here last week with us again. It's a real blessing to be together. As we said last week, you'll probably hear this each week, you know, one of the things we've loved in lockdown that we want to carry on is honouring and celebrating birthdays. And I might actually do a little addition to what we do with the birthdays. But firstly, James is going to show us a reminder of what birthdays we've had and are there any birthdays to come. So James, go for it.
Good morning to you all. We had three birthdays last week. Lexi celebrated her sixth birthday. Sam Marlowe had her birthday on Wednesday. And yesterday, Bonnie celebrated her second birthday. We don't have any birthdays to celebrate next week.
There are no birthdays to come next week, so you don't have to remember. So I don't know, if you don't know this, Wendy has it. There is a list of birthdays. If you want to be on the front foot of knowing whose birthdays are coming up so you can send them a card, then you don't have to wait till Sunday to find out. You can get a list from Wendy. But we'll do this most weeks. I think let's just pray a blessing upon those birthdays. Sam, Lexi and Bonnie, we're going to pray a blessing upon them. When was your birthday, Rachel? We did celebrate your birthday. It was the week before, wasn't it? Was it last Sunday? Or was it?
No, it was Tuesday.
Last Tuesday? The Tuesday before, Aaron.
Tuesday before.
You see, I'll pray a blessing on Rachel anyway, right? But you only get 1 week. There's just 1 week window, right? You don't get to celebrate for 2 weeks, but let's pray a blessing. Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for anniversaries and birthdays and special days. And Lord, we pray a blessing upon Sam and Lexi and Bonnie and Rachel, Lord Jesus. May they really know a great year ahead. Lord, all you have in store for them. Amen. Let's pray for our young ones as well as they go. Lord, we thank you for our junior church. We thank you for our junior church teachers and, Lord, for the children in the junior church. Lord, we thank you for the blessing of the space they've now got in the back there, Lord, where they can make it their own. And we pray, Lord, all they learn and do this morning, Lord, would draw them closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I should also take a moment to recognise that we are not just the church in this room, are we? We're the church at home as well. And you know, it's our vision and our hope that people would be here. But we also want to make sure that when people can't be here, they're not well, or they're, you know, sometimes people watch it from the car, or they're visiting the universities and things like that. People who are apart, feel this is their home but are not able to be with us, that they are also welcomed. So Anna and Abigail and Hannah and Sam, Chris, good to have you with us. And anyone else who is anonymous on the online, it's good to have you with us. Let me pray before I share the word of God. And let me move this as well. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you that it's alive and it nourishes us and encourages us and challenges us and speaks to us. Lord, thank you that in this land where we live, Lord, we have free access to the Word of God. Lord, we've got it in many translations and versions and concordances and resources. Lord, we're so overwhelmingly blessed with the abundance of your Word, and so we don't take that for granted. And we lift to you those today who don't have the easy access to the Word of God. Lord, we pray that there will be an expansion of your Word throughout this world, we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, I want to start with asking you a question for you to... you haven't got to shout out the answer, but I want you to maybe ponder it in your heart and wonder. Are you happy with the way you are? Are you happy with the way you are, with who you are? With the way that you are, the way that you tick, with what goes on inside you? Are you happy with you the way you are? Is there something about you that you would like to get changed? Is there a part of you that you want to change? You know, we live in a society where there is a lot of effort, money, energy put into changing. There is an expansion in gyms and sports and coaching and transformation in the world around us. And you might look and think, yeah, that's not who I am. Or maybe you already think, yeah, you're speaking to me. I wanted to try and get you to see that we probably mostly, if not all of us, have some interest and some appetite for change. And hopefully this is going to work, James. So, James, there's slides on there, and if I'm not controlling them, you might have to click. So you're on... No, don't do that. Do it onto a main one with them on the bottom. Just like you would for worship. I'll let James worry about that. So, like, James, just look on your screen on the right-hand side. Not that one, the middle one. We'll get there. And I missed in my little notices. Poor James, he had a crash course over Zoom at the weekend. And then this morning, he had to manage everything. I was saying to James, it's like the Matrix. If you see people on the Matrix who've got two guns and they're firing at people in two different directions, he's got two mouses, two computers he's controlling and doing all that. So James, what I want is I want slide with the pictures on there and then I want them to be on the screen. So if you click on the middle screen there, what you're going to see is, so I'm going to shout them out, TV programs that you may watch, right? And James will get them on the screen. So if you watch, you can put your hand up if you watch any of these TV programs, right? Scrap Heap Challenge, Ground Force, Escape to the Country, 10 Years Younger, Queer Eye, any of these programs, they're all about transformation, right? They're all about being changed. They're all about other people wanting to change, or you're watching other people changing. Or what about the books that you may read? So if you've read any of these books up here, or books like them, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, or a Tap to Tidy. Anyone into Tap to Tidy with Stacey Solomon? No, Dave doesn't want to. You, I was with you with Ground Force and Scrap Heap Challenge. You were there, weren't you, right, mate? Right? Dare to Lead, Renee Brown, or Becoming by Michelle Obama. What about the apps that you may have on your phone? Has anyone got Calm or Headspace or Fitbit or Strava or... Right, so you know, you get the impression that we are all have this thing about wanting to change. The world is looking for change to be made in our lives. And it begs the question, how do we change? When there's stuff about us that we want to change, how does change happen? How do we go about it? And And what would you say, you can shout the answer to this, right? What would you say if you had a friend or someone you was talking to who said, I really want to change my life, what would you point them towards? The clue here, we're in church, right, okay? What would you point them towards if you wanted them to change? You would say? Oh, we heard church, we heard the Bible, Jesus. If ever you wonder in church, the answer's Jesus, right? So, Sunday school kids learn this, right? The answer's Jesus, right? Right? When you became a Christian, a change took place within you. But if we reel about it, although we know a change took place within us, we became born again, why is it that you and I still want to change? A change takes place within us when we are saved, when we come to Jesus, but there is another change that goes on that doesn't happen in a blink of an eye. It doesn't happen overnight. We have a vision for this church, which is that people's lives would be transformed through a relationship with Jesus. Not just by meeting him. Not just by that conversion moment. Not just by saying a prayer that says, I want you in my life, Lord. But that through a relationship with Jesus, through an ongoing relationship with Jesus, we would change. And when you think about any form of change within yourself, it's not overnight. I can really, really want to get fit, but it isn't going to happen overnight. I can want to get some qualification and some knowledge. It's not going to happen overnight. I can want to lose some weight. It's not going to happen overnight. I might want to get promoted or get 10,000 followers on Instagram. It's not going to happen overnight. These things are a steady thing. But interestingly, change isn't a mystical thing that you just kind of wish for in the universe and hopefully these things will happen. There's a plan. There's a work, an effort. This morning's message is called Working Out Your Salvation. And there's a working out of how we change. Now, I don't know, to be honest with you, right? I don't know how you become your best self, right? I'm not the person to ask about how you get fitter or how you get more calmer or how you get more knowledge or a tidier house. I'm not the person to ask. But I do know how you become more like Jesus. And that's what we're going to think about this morning. So if you've got your Bibles with you, I pray you do. I ask you to grab your Bibles and turn to Philippians. We're going to look in the book of Philippians, and just two verses I want to focus on, although we will look at some others around it. But I want you to focus on two verses in the book of Philippians. And we're going to look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 to 13. So grab your Bible, have a look at Philippians chapter 2, 12 to 13. And this is what it says in Philippians 2, 12 to 13. I'm reading here from the ESV. It says, therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. We are going to look at and learn this morning how transformation happens. How we're changed. I mean, like the important stuff. Deep down, the real change that needs to take place within us. But before I get stuck in, I want you to kind of have some foundation here, because if you launch into a sermon like this and you've got some misunderstanding, then you'll be set off on the wrong trajectory. So just to understand a few things. Firstly, just let me tell it back a second. Look at these words that Paul says. He starts by saying, my dear friends. Paul is speaking to the Philippians, his dear friends. I am speaking this morning to my dear friends. When I look out at you guys, you are my dear friends. Paul is not speaking from some absent relationship. He's speaking out of friendship. My message to you this morning is out of my friendship to you. And secondly, he's saying in this that I'm speaking to you because you've obeyed when I'm there. He's saying, look, you're doing great things. He's when you look at Paul, he writes some letters to people to tell them off. He writes to do some drastic correction. He speaks quite sternly and quite harshly. When he writes to the Philippians, he says, I'm writing to my friends. You guys are doing great. I want you to go even further with God. I want you to go even deeper with him. I've seen what you can do. I want you to get even further. And so I want you to understand this morning that this message, that Paul's heart is exactly my heart this morning.
As I come to prepare for this, I'm like, I know I'm speaking to my dear friends, and I know I'm speaking to people who are going on with Jesus and want to go deeper with Jesus, who want to go further, who want to discover more about him. So Philippians is not a telling off. It's an encouragement. But when we get into this word, there's an understanding I want us to get, because it all hinges around salvation. I don't know if you think there's a difference between these words. What do you think the words Christian, disciple, and follower of Jesus mean? Do they mean the same thing? Are they different things? If I called you a Christian, or if I called you a follower of Jesus, or if I called you a disciple, would you think I'm saying the same thing? Guy's got a stern no. I've got some yeses here. Who thinks when I say that, I'm saying the same thing? And who thinks when I say that, I'm saying actually quite a different thing? Well, you're right and you're wrong. Because quite frankly, they should mean the same thing. They should. But often, when we hear the word follower of Jesus or disciple, that has a different connotation to it than just I'm wearing this badge called Christian. Just going to stick the sticker on and go, I'm a Christian. I've got my badge. And so I want to use an example to try and bring this to life for you. Because we have a conception of what it means to be saved. So in these verses, when he's talking about working out your salvation, depends on how you view it, depends on how you'll understand this. And I've got to say, there's a right way and a wrong way to understand it. So many people have a wrong understanding of salvation. I want you to see this lectern here and imagine a line. And what they see is there's this side of the line. Thank you, James. Yeah, I won't get off screen. There's this side of the line. There's those who are not saved. That's our non-Christians, they're unsaved. People are not Christians, our non-Christians. And then there's this line here. Lord Jesus, I accept you into my heart. I'm sorry for my sins, forgive me. And now I'm on this side of the line. I'm in the Christian camp. And all of us here are merrily in our Christian camp, and all those unchristians there are there. And we look at people and we go, they're getting closer to the line. I can see them. God's drawing them in. They're going to say that prayer any day now. They've been coming to church for a while, and we have this view that's like, I'm in the camp, I'm out the camp. There's those who are not saved and those who are. And I want you to have a different perspective. I was just lining it up for the edge of the screen there, James, and you went bigger. Anyway, right? So I want you to see this here. This is not the line now of becoming a Christian. This is Jesus. And all of us are here wandering around. And the reality is some people are wandering aimlessly, oblivious of the fact there is Jesus all over the place. And then there are those who repent and turn and face towards Jesus. And the steps that they make are about getting closer to Jesus. It's about getting closer to Jesus, because, let me put this up to help you, salvation is a direction, not a destination. That doesn't mean there isn't a moment when a change happens in our heart. That change happens when we turn around and we face towards Jesus and say, Jesus, I want to follow you. Jesus, would you take hold of my life? Jesus, I've done wrong. Would you forgive me? And we set ourselves on a path that the word Christian and disciple and follower of Jesus are the same thing, which is I am following Jesus. And the great thing is we still see people getting closer to that. We see people getting closer to turning. That still happens. You might have people that you're praying for, or you're trying to welcome into the church or tell about Jesus, and you're like, they're almost there. But it's not that they're jumping into a camp. What they're doing is they're changing the direction of their life. That is what a follower of Jesus means. And so when Paul is talking about working out our salvation, he's not talking about how do we cross the line, because he's speaking to the Philippians. All of them are saved. He's not writing to them saying, here's how you work out how to get saved. He's going, you're working out the direction of your travel. You're working out how to become more like Jesus. So this passage that we're reading is not about those who are on the wrong side of a line. Not about those who don't know Jesus. It's to those who have set their face on Jesus. What we call disciples. You know, in the New Testament, the word Christian appears 3 times. The word disciple in the New Testament appears 269 times. When Jesus spoke to the to his disciples and said, go out into all the world and make disciples. He's saying, go out into all the world and make disciples and teach them to follow my way. He didn't go get a badge on them. Go get them to say a prayer. Go get them to call themselves Christians. He goes, go and make disciples. I might wonder, well, what does the disciple mean? Because as much as it's used 269 times, the Bible's not a dictionary with a definition. So some wiser people than me have all given a go at trying to describe this. So these are some quotes from some wiser people than me. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, if you've heard of him, many of you have, some of you won't know who he is, but he was a wise man. He said this, he said, a disciple is one who adheres to Christ. You're sticking to Christ. Dallas Willard said, the disciples are the ones whose desire above all else to be like Christ. Henry Blackby, I've never heard of him. Anyone heard of Henry Blackby? I don't know who he is, but I like what he says. He says, one being taught by many means intentionally in a specific direction. Steve Murrell, another guy I don't know of, but I like what he says. Following Jesus, fishing for people, doing this in fellowship with others. You know, all these different definitions, there's many out there of people trying to nail what it is. They've all got something in common. This concept of being a disciple is about continually moving towards. It's this direction, which is I'm following Jesus and I'm continually moving towards being more like him. So how do we do that? How do we continually move towards being like Jesus? That is what we signed up for when we gave our life to Jesus. We didn't say, Lord, get me into heaven. I'm sorry if that's what you thought you prayed. What we prayed was, Lord, come into my life. Be the Lord of my life. I want to follow you all my days. And what we find in this little two verses that we read, and also in some of the words around it, but very, you know, centrally in these two verses, there are three different parties at work. Three different parties at work. And just let me actually, I'm going to click around a bit. Let me go back to that verse and show you it, right? There's three different things at work. Firstly, just see those words. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, now not only in my presence, but much more in my absence. I want to tell you, and I'll explain it a bit more, that one of the parties involved in your transformation to being more like Jesus is the church. Then he says, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Another one of the parties at work is you. You working out your salvation with fear and trembling. And then thirdly, the third party at work is God. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. There are three people at work, or three parties: the church, you, and God. The church. Salvation is worked with the church. Salvation is worked out by you. And salvation is worked in by God. If you didn't write that down quick enough, it's fine. That's my three points. We're going to go over that. But just ahead of time, I want you to see that salvation is worked with the church. It's worked out by you and it's worked in by God. Let me start with the church. Salvation is worked with the church. It's interesting, really, because he doesn't indicate here that the primary, you know, these three little parties, okay, there's you and there's God and there's this other thing. This other thing is not here. It's not me, actually. He doesn't put the finger on the pastor. He doesn't put the finger on the preacher who's preaching or the teaching. He puts it on the church. And why he does it? Because he says, look, I'm not always here. That's where he starts. He says, I've been there, but then I'm absent. Now, Paul's absence was pretty extreme. He'd spend a couple of years with them, and then he'd travel elsewhere, and he'd do it all by writing. My absence is that I'm here for an hour and a half on a Sunday morning. Nice to see you. You have all these other hours where I'm not around. The focus is not on me. The focus is on the church. What Paul is saying, he's going, I love seeing your progress. That's his sentiment to them, going, I've seen it. I've been there with you. I've seen you. I come to this morning, like Charisse, I'm thrilled to hear the praises of heaven. I'm thrilled to see, you know, how you're getting on. But then I'm not around. And Paul says, you know, when I'm not here, keep going. That's his heart. You know, I got to tell you, I had a nice lunch with Guy and Mary on Friday. I'm trying to remember my diary. You know, one of the things I was sharing to them, was just that in lockdown, I've discovered a rhythm to my life that keeps me sane. It's a very busy Monday to Friday, it's a restful Saturday, and it's church on Sunday. And I never used to have that rhythm. It was like 24/7, go, go, go all the time. But in that, I've had to realise that there's a limited things I can do. And I've got to tell you, my heart aches that there's not more I can do. I so wish I could put on more teaching. I'd have time to prepare it and host groups for it. I so wish I could have coffees with many of you and sit down and have spiritual conversations. I wish I could counsel many of you. I wish I could spend time praying with you. I so wish, it's like Paul's going, I wish I could be there, but I can't. I can't. And so what Paul does is he puts his focus on the church. And that's where the other verses around it come in. The great thing is, if you're going to read anything, do you remember I said last week? I think it was last week. It's only been here 1 week. It must have been last week. I said, you know, verses are great, but when you really understand them, you get a much better view. And often we really understand them by reading around them. And so when we get to verse 13 and 14, there's a whole bunch of stuff that's gone on before that leads up to it. And it kind of starts to pivot in his kind of sections of his letter in verse 27 of chapter 1. So let me read to you chapter 1, verse 27 through to chapter 2, verse 4. This is what he says. He says, above all, you must live as citizens of heaven, conducting yourselves in a manner worthy of the good news about Christ. Then whether I come and see you again or only hear about you, I will know that you are standing together with one spirit and one purpose, fighting together for the faith, which is the good news. Don't be intimidated in any way by your enemies. This will be a sign to them that they are going to be destroyed, but that you are going to be saved even by God himself. For you have been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for him. We are in this struggle together. You have seen my struggle in the past, and you know that I'm still in the midst of it. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try and impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. Now, those of you who haven't got your Bibles open are going to struggle now. Those of you who do, or maybe you've got a good memory, what did you hear? Or what do you see on your page? Shout it out, or from your memory, that was together stuff. Fighting. There was another word after it. Fighting together. Yeah, fighting together. Anything else you remember, or you can look in your Bible and see words there that were about when you're smiling. You didn't have your Bible with you. Anyone else? Striving together. Darren, you look like you're about to say something, you know? Standing together. But have a quick look on the screen, right? There's some words here. Just look for things. There, Darren's one was there, standing together. What's the words that come after it? One spirit. One purpose. Fighting together is a bit that Dave said. What else on this screen over here? Right. Struggle together. For we're struggling together. What about here? Being united. Any fellowship together in the Spirit. He's not talking alone, is he? He's talking about them being together. What about that last bit? Agreeing wholeheartedly with each other. Let's find a topic. See where we disagree, right? Agreeing wholeheartedly with each other. There's loads on this last bit. Shout them out, anyone who wants to. Working together. I'm only repeating you for the mic, right, for those on the online. What else are you reading? First three words. Loving one another. What about don't try and impress others? Think of others as better than yourselves. Do you see, all his focus here is the church. It's about us being together. You get this picture of what I call unity wrapped in love. These great phrases. You know, 90 minutes on a Sunday morning is not enough. And practically gathering us together every day is not enough either. We're not practically, you know, achievable. But we, as a body, his encouragement is, the way that we grow is together. We were never called to be apart. We were never called to just live our own little Christian life by ourselves. We were called to be part of a body. You know, we need each other. And I love I love the way that we connect on Facebook. I love the way when I hear about people texting each other, people having coffees together, people going out for fun things together, people having people in their homes, people phoning each other up. That is how we grow together. I have a very strong inclination, I'm not launching anything today, but we're going to have to figure out ways as a church that we do more together in order for us to grow together. We're going to. If we really want to set our hearts on being transformed by Jesus, growing more like him, and in doing so, transforming the world around us, we're not going to do it alone. You can go so far by yourself, and you definitely can. We're going to get onto your work in a moment. But there's a work that happens together. And he paints this picture about the fact that this salvation has been worked out with others. And again, that's why my massive encouragement, even for those who are like joined us online but can't geographically be near us, it's like, get plugged into a local church. This is not enough. You've got to form relationships and bonds and friendship, people who can speak into your life. Not everyone's going to be able to speak into your life and you're going to take it. Some of you are going to be like, excuse me, I don't really want to hear you talking about it. But there's others, close friends, who can say things that only a close friend can say. We're going to have to be together. So salvation is worked with the church. It's worked in by God. What do we read in that verse 13? For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purposes. I took that verse and I read it in a number of different versions because some of the versions are really colourful and they really bring it to life. So listen to this from the New Living Translation. It just says, for God is working inside of you. In the Message, it says this, that energy is God's energy, an energy deep within you, God himself willing and working at what will give him the most pleasure. You might struggle with the word energy because it sounds a bit mystic, but actually the Greek word for working is energio. It's where we get the word energy. It's this force that God is working within us. He's changing us. He's working within us. And again, this passage doesn't sit by itself. We just read verse 1:27 through to 2:4. Well, there's a bit between 2:4 and 2:13 that we got to, which is 2:5 to 11. Again, he's leading up to this, and it's a very famous bit. It's a poem, in actual fact, that Paul pens in his letter, and he says this, he says, you must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he didn't think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God, and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all names, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You know what word comes after that in verse 13? Therefore. Therefore, you know, Jesus sets his example, and it's interesting, actually, when I really started to look at this and think about it, it's interesting that it says that Jesus didn't count equality with God something to grasp, something to cling to, something to hang on to, but instead he poured out, instead he gave up, instead he sacrificed. And I want to teach you a strange concept at first, but it is really true, and as I explain it more, you go, oh, I get it. Which is this, that you grow by being like Jesus, by not trying to be like Jesus. You're like, right, what? Hang on. I thought we were trying to be like Jesus. I'm really modeling my life on him, aren't I? Jesus had equality with God. And it says He didn't seek to strive to hold on to that. That wasn't his focus, hanging on to how I can still be God, clinging on to equality. What he said was, I'm not worried about that. My focus is going to be on pouring myself out. As he poured himself out, he was glorified even more to the place of highest honor. You know, you can't, a little squeak there, you can't do barely anything. Just think about these natural goals. You can't make yourself slimmer. You can't lose weight. I can't stand here now. I mean, if I want to lift this cup, I can. I can do that. If I want to lift this, I can do that. I can't stand here and go, I'm now going to lose weight. Watch it fall off me. You can't. What, you know, wouldn't it be great if you could, eh? Wowee, right? But what we know is what you can do is you can do other things that create a great environment for the body to be able to lose weight. You can exercise more, eat less. Exercising more and eating less is not losing weight. It's doing something different that leads to losing weight. You want to tend your garden, you can't make that plant grow. You can't stare at it and go, it's going to grow, I'm going to make it grow. And then you go and get a plant and you kind of cable tie it onto it. Look, there's a leaf coming up here and then you get a plant. You can't, it's weird. What you can do is tend it. Give it good soil. Water it. Make sure the sun comes out. Make it, it's in a prominent position where the sun's going to get it. You can create a fertile environment for growth, but you can't make it grow. And that's so much what the Christian life is like. Jesus didn't set his sights on how can I be highly exalted? How can I maintain equality with God? How can I reach the pinnacle of my glorification? He said, no, I'm going to just focus on pouring myself out. And so you can't make growth happen in you, spiritual growth. And the weird thing is when you try to, you go backwards because you turn it into this legalistic effort thing where you're trying to earn something. You can't do that. What you can do is do the things that lead to growth. Because when we do that, then change happens. And so God is working within us, just like this plant I just described. When I water a plant, not that I do that very often, but when I water a plant and put it where Karen tells me to so the sun will get to it and deadhead the bits that she says that's the dead bit and that's not right, when I do that, I am doing my bit, and the force, the energy, the thing that happens in plants is working with inside it to do its bit. And so God is working inside of you to do his bit. What he says is there's something for you to do, which is this working out our salvation. And so salvation is worked out by you. It's interesting, isn't it? He says, he doesn't say work for your salvation. That'd be a completely different verse, right? He doesn't say work on your salvation. That would be what I just spoke about there. Like, I'm gonna become more like Jesus. What would Jesus do? No. He says, work out your salvation. And in these verses around it, you can study it for yourself. You can look as well, but I've done a bit of the hard work for you. There are three themes that come out that he seems to focus on when he's talking about working out your salvation. And the first theme is about loving each other. We spoke about it earlier. Not only does the church have a role in a place where we grow together, we get to grow by loving others. That's how we get to grow. That is like our exercise for us to lose weight. That's the thing we do externally so that God's transforming work can happen within us. Because loving others isn't easy. I don't know if you've realized that. Right, it's not easy. So we read some of this stuff before. Verse 3 says, don't be selfish. Think of others as better than yourselves. You know, I said earlier, I can lift this, I can do that. I can't lose weight by thinking about it, but I can do this. And in the same way, this instruction here, this instruction that says don't be selfish, you can do that. You can make a choice to not be selfish. You can make a choice to value others better than yourself. That is something you can do. First, I was listening to a podcast recently, and it was just talking about superstars within the Christian world. And how we've fallen into this trap as Christians nowadays, that there are superstars. Big name preachers, big ministries. And we're like, oh, one day, if only I could be like. And quite frankly, I don't know who, you know, if that fits with you. If you've got some Christian idol that you're like, wow, aren't they amazing, that you look up to, and you look, oh, I could never be like them. I could never, you know, have that ministry or, right, you know. But someone like Mother Teresa, you can be like her. You can just go and feed the poor. You can go do that. But we don't want to do the sacrificial stuff, the humble stuff. We set our sights on the stardom. But this stuff, this is achievable. Don't be selfish. It says in verse 4, don't look out for yourself. Take an interest in others. That's an action that Paul's describing the stuff we can do. He's like, you can't make yourself be like Jesus, but you know, that's an inner work that God's doing, but you can get yourself in fertile soil. You can love each other. Do everything without complaining and arguing. I'm not saying this is easy. Right? Doing everything without complaining and arguing is not easy. But it's something that we do. And like I said earlier, you know, if I set myself on a goal that I want to run the marathon next year, it's not going to happen by wishing. It's going to happen by training. It's going to happen by intentionality. And in the same way, when we're like, I want to become more like Jesus, I want to be a follower of Jesus, I don't want to just wear a Christian badge, I want to go on with him, it takes some intentionality. So there's stuff in there about loving each other. There's also stuff in these verses about obedience to the word of God. Verse 12 in chapter 2 says, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. There's this awe that says, God, I'm going to follow you. I'm going to obey you. I'm going to do what you say. Verse 16, after the verse we read, talks about holding firmly to the word of life. It's valuing the word of God. I'm holding my phone because this is where I mostly read the word of God, right? It's valuing, I'm not valuing the phone, right? The Bible app, imagine that. I should have brought my Bible with it for a better visual aid. But you know what I mean, right? This is going to be a central part of my life. That is one of the massive keys to growing more like Jesus, is valuing the word of God. He's a beat, not just, and Jesus said this when he did the story of the wise man who built his house on the sand and the wise man who built his house on the rock, foolish man who built his house on the sand. He said, the one who put his house on the rock was the one who heard my words and put them into practice. So it's not just, our encouragement to you is not just to have a daily Bible reading. That's great. It's just going to be walked off a duck's back. It's about obedience to the word of God. Saying, I want to follow God's word. This is the living word. And then thirdly, he brings out in these verses around this about sacrificial living. We got this in the example of Jesus, who humbled himself and poured himself out and gave himself unto death, even death on a cross. Paul, when he talks in a couple of verses after we read in verse 17, he says, even if I lose my life, I'm pouring it out like a liquid offering to God. Jesus said, you know, whoever loses his life will find it. And so, you know, today is just a skirt over the surface of this. My intention today, clearly, or I want to make it clear for you, my intention today is not to guide you in all things that have become more like Jesus, but to make sure that we have a perspective that isn't, I've crossed the line, I'm in my ticket to heaven, I'm a Christian, I go to church every Sunday. It's one that says, I am facing towards Jesus, I've set my face on him, and I've made it my life's work to become more like him. Not by striving to be like him, but by putting into practice the things he tells me that I can do. Loving others. Obeying the word of God, living sacrificially. You know, I said earlier that I can really relate to where Paul's coming from. I really can. I really, you know, as I read this, and you know, it's like when you prepare a word, you study it, you read it, you read it, you read it again, you let it really saturate you. And as I read this, I'm like, I'm really capturing the heart of this man. He's talking to his dear friends. And as I imagine coming today, I'm like, I know I'm going to be talking to my dear friends, because you are. You're not strangers. I've not been invited to the church down the road who I don't know. This is our church. You're my dear friends. And you're also not people who are far from God. I'm not sitting here saying, guys, we're all living sinfully and we need to buck our ideas up. That's not the message. It's one that says, you know what? God's got great things for you. He wants us to go deeper with him. This is an encouragement to you to go deeper with him, urging them, just like Paul did. Urging them to become citizens of heaven. He says that, seeing as you are citizens of heaven, that's where your home really is, live a life worthy of it, worthy of the gospel that we declare. Set your face on Jesus. And, you know, I'm aware that, well, I don't know if I'm aware of this. I'm assuming, because I don't know what goes on inside human hearts. But I'm assuming that some of you today have had a wake-up call. You've had a wake-up call that has challenged your perspective of, I don't want to either. I got in there. I said that prayer and I come to church and I'm a Christian. I wear that label. And I'm hoping and praying that some of you have had a wake-up call. That you're not a Christian as is so glibly defined, but you can equally own the title disciple or follower of Jesus and go, that's actually who I'm called to be. And again, I want to remind you, Jesus said, take my yoke upon you, my burden is light, my yoke is easy. And so if you have had that wake-up call that goes, I've got to follow Jesus, there's more I've got to do. Jesus says, follow me. My yoke is easy. This stuff that the world puts on you is effort and hard. And I'm not saying it's not effort, but it's easy. Because he's working within you. You haven't got to prove yourself to him. You haven't got to earn it. He's doing the work within you. He says, just get in fertile soil. Take one step, one intentional step to say, okay, I've heard what's been said. When something might have struck you, you go, I need to do that a bit more. It might be about loving people more in the church. It might be about reading the word and going, oh, that's what it says. How do I put that into practice? It might be sacrificial living. I don't know. But just take one little step that says, I'm not just going to have my face towards Jesus. I'm going to make steps towards him. I'm going to do things intentionally to move towards Jesus. I also reckon, an assumption of mine, that some of you are like, yes, Trevor, if only everyone else would get it. This is your life. You're like, yeah, I'm a disciple of Jesus. That's what my life is about. And I want to say, keep going. Keep going because, you know, that's what it's about. It's not about arriving. It's not about going, I've done it. I've got the certificate. I've got the badge. It's not. I'm not sure I am, despite your beliefs, I'm not sure I'm actually the most mature Christian in this room right now. You might think I am, I'm not. Even if I was, the journey is not over. It's a daily call to live sacrificially, to lay my life down, to let the Word of God reveal to me more things that I need to surrender, more things that I need to, more people I need to love. Keep going. And some of you, again, assumption on my part, thought you were safe. Was sold a gospel once upon a time that is, say this prayer, and then you're a Christian, you're done. And I'm sorry if you were sold that gospel, because it's not true. Now, I don't want to equally get anyone confused. It's not like one day you're a Christian and one day you're not. It's not like when you have a bad day and you don't read your Bible and, what's God up to? You suddenly, like, turned your face away and you're no longer a Christian, you've lost your salvation. Don't get hung up on that. But what it is when we truly come to Christ, when we truly give our heart to him, we set our life in a new direction and we say, Jesus, take it. And progressively, day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year, decade by decade, he does a work in our lives and transforms us. So I'm going to wrap up just in a second. I'll ask the band to come back because we're going to sing in a moment. And I want to wrap this up in a way that might seem odd to you. Because when I look around the room, I'm pretty sure everybody in this room is saved. I'm pretty sure of that. I'm pretty sure every one of you at some point has said, I gave my life to Jesus. And when I was preparing this, I knew that would probably be the case as well. But what I want to wrap up with is actually saying what many of us call the sinner's prayer. Because I want you to recognize that prayer that we prayed when we gave our life to Jesus, it's a daily prayer. I mean, you can only be saved once. You only get saved once. There's a moment when you give your life to Jesus, new life appears within you. You are born again. You were once dead, now you're alive. That is a one-time deal. But being saved is a daily thing. It says this in 1 Corinthians, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved. To us who are being saved, it is the power of God. And so what I want to end with is asking you, and the nice thing is in a crowd, people can tell whether you do this or not. So it's up to you. But I want to ask you to repeat after me a prayer that you'd have heard many times, that is often people pray for the first time, giving their life to Jesus. And as you pray those words, because you are a disciple, because you're a follower of Jesus, I want you to hear the words that you're praying and not just see them as a once upon a time prayer, but as the daily prayer. The daily prayer. Not that every day you need to wake up in the morning and go, I need to get saved again. I hope I'm not confusing anyone in that, right? You're not getting saved each morning. Right? It's done. But the daily choice to go, Jesus, I want to follow after you. Jesus, I need you, is the daily prayer of a disciple. You might pray it in different ways, in different words. It's not some magic formula that you say. And so I want to invite you, everyone can stand, please. And I'm going to pray. You've probably heard this before when people give the last Jesus. I'm going to pray and ask you to repeat after me. But quite frankly, don't bother if you don't want to be a disciple of Jesus. I don't mean that sounded really passive-aggressive, didn't it, right? But you know what I mean? It's like, it doesn't matter to me. Well, it does matter to me. I love you, and I want you all to be followers of Jesus. But I don't want you to say it to make me happy. I don't want you to say it because what's the person next to you going to think? I want you to say it because it is a prayer of your heart. And also because I have no idea who might be watching online, or actually the state of anyone's heart in this room. It might be the first time you've said it. Or maybe the first time you said it with sincerity. Don't let it be the last time you say it. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you love me. Thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross for me, that I can follow you and become more like Jesus. I admit that I'm not perfect. I've sinned and I've followed my selfish ways. Thank you, Jesus paid the price for all my sins. And I receive your forgiveness. I declare that Jesus is Lord of my life. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Work within my life so I can follow you. Change my desires so I can live as a citizen of heaven. I give my all to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Charisse is going to lead us in a song that just speaks to the fact that, you know, everyone needs this love of God. Not just the world out there, but us. And he can move mountains in your life and in my life. Some of those things happen overnight, but many of them happen over a lifetime. God is moving mountains in our life as we set our face upon him.
Just stay standing. Just want to read to you the verses that this message was on. Just speak them over you as a blessing and as a charge to you. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Lord, I pray a blessing upon everyone here. Oh, Lord Jesus, each of us, Lord, seek to follow you each day. Lord, our challenges and our struggles are different. Our relationship with the place we find ourselves with you may be different, but Lord, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever, and your heart is towards us. And so I pray, Lord, as we go into this day and this week and what's ahead of us, Lord, help us, Lord, to love each other more. Lord, to listen and obey your word, to treasure it in our hearts, Lord, to live our lives sacrificially as you did, to lay our lives down. And Lord, may we progressively, steadily, more and more each day, be transformed more into the image of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Take a seat. Just one last thing just to say before we close. Just notices wise, it might sound like the same. Tuesday, Zoom. Friday, prayer at Wendy's. Back to church on Sunday. We've made a little tweak to Tuesdays that I want to tell you about, which is instead of spending the whole hour and a half praying, we're spending about the first 35 minutes talking about the Bible, particularly talking about the Bible that we read on that Sunday just gone. So on Tuesday, we'll read this a bit more and we'll share. What do you think that means and how does that work? We did that this week. It was a real blessing. Growing together, sharing the word with each other. And then we moved into prayer. And I want you to know that for two reasons. One, because I want to highly recommend it's a great way to grow together. You know, there are things to do by yourself, but like I said, we grow together. And so if you can make Tuesday on Zoom to just come and read the word together and just share, you haven't got to speak up, you can listen to others, it's fine, there's no pressure. But also, it may be you can't spare the whole of a Tuesday evening because, you know, life is busy for you, or you know, early to bed or whatever, different shifts and whatever. You could join us for 35 minutes. And then when we move into prayer, you can quietly slip out the back door of Zoom and just leave. It's fine. It's okay. So yeah, just be aware of that. The other thing I want to say, which I meant to say last week and I meant to say this week in the notices and I finally remembered, is just a little bit of housekeeping about this live stream. Because one of the things that we were concerned about when we wanted to go back to church in the building and go on the internet so that people can see it is we didn't want it to hinder anybody in the room feeling like, I'm not getting up the front there, I'm not saying anything, I'm not sharing a testimony or I'm not reading something that God's given me or a prophecy or a vision. We are a body that wants to move in those things. And so you might feel intimidated by the fact that, yeah, but it's going out on the internet. So I want to tell you, I can't stop it going out on the internet live right now. But when the service is finished, we don't have to put it up on the internet forever. We can edit a bit out. So if you want to share a testimony and have a little look and go, oh, phew, it's only Vanessa and Sam and Anna. I don't mind sharing it with them and share it. And then at the end, you go, I don't really want that testimony out there for anyone who might stumble across it. We can snip that bit out and then put the rest of the service up. That's fine. I can't kind of edit it in the service. But we can control it afterwards. And so I want you to know that because we want to, as we get back together and back into the swing of things and back used to it, I want you to feel bolder and bolder to share. If there's something that's gone on during the week, saying that God's given you, feel free to share that. And then we can, you know, if you speak to me afterwards and go, can you make sure that's not on YouTube forever? We can sort that out. So just so you know that, we really want that. And I suppose the flip side is true. You might have something to share and you never want to stand at the front. You can do a video and we can show it, just like the birthday video. So, you know, it works both ways. But we want to encourage you to participate and just be part of the church. Well, we're done for this morning. If you're on the live stream, have a great week. See you later. If you're sticking around, hopefully you brought a tea or coffee or something with you to drink because we're not doing teas and coffees yet. We will get back to that, but we're not there yet. And if you can stick around, please do. We'd love you to go outside where the air is fresher, but I understand some people might get cold, so don't feel you have to, but there are benches out there. And otherwise, have a blessed week Have a great time, encourage one another, and may God be with you. Amen. Amen.